Evening, welcome to our planning committee. Can I check if everybody in the room can hear us? Welcome then, my name is Stuart Kelly, I'm the chair of the committee. Can I please ask that all mobile phones are turned off or to silence? This meeting will be webcast and the record will be taken on the council website. The cameras are set to follow the microphones. Members, please remember to use your microphone when speaking. If the applicants, petitioners or agents do not wish to be filmed, please let me know before you take your seat to speak. My role is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regards to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people are, to my right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on procedural and legal matters that may arise, and the minute taker and webcasters. To my left are the planning officers, highway engineers and environmental health officer, who will present the applications and provide any technical advice that may be required. Down the sides of the tables are the elected members, who will consider the applications and collectively make the decisions. Voting will be by a show of hands. Each application will be introduced by the planning officers. Where there is a qualifying petition of 25 signatures or more, I will invite a representative of the petitioners to address the committee for 5 minutes. I will then invite the applicants or their agent to address the committee again for 5 minutes. Statutory or local consultees may also address the committee. A ward councillor can also address the committee. Once representations have been made, and following any questions or clarification committee members may have, the speaker must return to the public area and may not participate in any debate that follows within the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. When making decisions, members may only have regard to material planning considerations. It is a matter for each member individually to balance these considerations and to decide what weight to give them. Members will also have regard to our local planning policies and to the National Planning Framework and Guidance. The order of tonight's agenda will be varied dependent upon the number of people in attendance for a specific item. Okay, thereby open our marks. We'll move first then to the minutes.
Sorry, through you, Chair. But the minutes don't accurately reflect the meeting that we had in the fact that there was any of the business of judicial review performed and none wasn't included, and Councillor Foulkes is suggesting that it is moved to the order of this committee, seconded by Councillor Ian Lewis, and then I also ask an update on the Wirral issue, and that's not mentioned in the minutes at all.
Okay.
Also, in the present is my name, here at the website, so that's correct.
I had noticed those two, and I've just received them. I didn't say too much.
Yeah. It's all that back on. Right. So, through you, Chair, I did register our complaint dissatisfaction about the change of date to 5 days for site visits and the briefing to 5 days. Almost all of my members have programmed their life around what was. Now what is making it very difficult for us. So I did want that to be minuted, and I want to formally ask you to have a consideration around that matter, given that it is extremely difficult for members of my group to attend site visits on a formal basis. I know we can go on site informally, but it's not the same as being given full access and briefing. So I'd ask you to reconsider that day and come back to the next committee with an answer.
Okay. So in terms of the minutes, I know a number of things we've picked up, notably the missing minutes and so far as our discussion on whether the business was concerned. So, Cecilia.
Yeah. We are aware that there are some amendments needed to the minutes, so what our intention is to not get them signed this evening. And we will amend them, we will say them, and we will be published.
Okay, is that okay? So, just directed to them, members of the committee are asked whether they have any personal or prejudicial interests with any application on the agenda, and if so, to declare them and to state the nature of the interests.
Thank you, Chair. Item 8, Roselands, Croft Drive and Colby. It's a personal interest, as I know one of the neighbours, that I've not been lobbied and I have not made a decision on the application prior to attending this meeting.
Thank you. Okay, in terms of the agenda order then, we're going to take agenda item 4, which is Cllr, followed by agenda item 11, which is Westway 16 Lingdale Road, followed by agenda item 5, which is 1 Caulfield Drive, Ezell, followed by agenda item 8, which is Roseland 16 Cross Drive, Colby, and then we will be there to agenda order. So we will start then with agenda item 4, Cllr, Protocol Road Committee.
Thank you, through you, Chair. So, Planning Commission is sought on the erection of 28 two-bedroom apartments with associated parking and landscaping works. The scheme provides for 100% affordable housing provision on site. The proposals will be contained within a single building that measures some 40 metres in length and almost 15 metres in depth, and would be located adjacent to the Brighton Hall Road boundary of the site. The building would be four-storey at a height of 12 metres and would be flat-roofed. The dwellings on the opposite side of Prenton Hall Road are located 27 metres away from the new building, and those on Dickens Avenue are situated 38 metres away. These distances meet the normal interface distances that would be required. Flats in Caithness Gardens do not have habitable room windows that face directly onto the new building. Parking is provided on site for 28 spaces, a ratio of one space per apartment, in keeping with supplementary plan document 4. Limited amenity space is provided within the scheme, but the site is within easy walking distance of Walker Park, Prenton Down, and there is an amenity space adjacent to the site on Coldsmiths Way. The site is within a sustainable location with easy access to public transport and other amenities. There is a welcome position.
Thank you. Is a representative of the petitioners present? Would you like to come forward?
Being a resident for 62 years.
I've been asked to speak on behalf of my community.
I've been a resident now for 62 years in Prenton, but more proudly, chairman of the Prenton Tenants and Residents Association for 20 years. I know my area almost inside out. Use of the application to knock down the dell and build 28 flats in its place came as a shock not only to me, but also the residents of the estate. A meeting at the PTRA in March, the members of the local community voiced their clear opposition to the application. We are all aware of the need of affordable homes and that the government has set a target for each council to meet, and I believe there is a penalty if the target is not met. However, one of our main objections is the excessive number of flats and dimensions of the proposed apartment block, which would swallow up a huge area of what is currently common space. Then there is parking problems. Around the area, within a radius of half a mile, we already have over 160 flats. 30 of those flats have parking areas, the rest don't. The current plan shows 28 parking spaces. We believe that this will not prevent a worsening of existing parkings and traffic. On your site visits on the 14th of June, members of the planning committee saw for themselves the narrowness of the roads which were built in the 50s and the 60s, and they're not designed to cope with today's traffic. The existing traffic island by the shops does little to ease the situation. There is also the issue of road safety. Residents in the area already have to cross Prenton Road, which is a very dangerous road. Children using the play area will also face another potential busy road, given the location of the proposed entrance to the flats. We are also concerned on behalf of the future tenants of the proposed flats, many of whom are expected to be disabled or have mobility issues. The planners mentioned in their application that we have a good bus service. This is untrue. The Prenton Hall Road and the Prenton community have lost their 83A bus service and it's been well publicised. It now takes residents 3/4 of an hour or more to get to Birkenhead. The only alternative is to walk half a mile to Woodchurch Road, either to catch a bus to town or even further to Beach London shops. Many people with mobility difficulties are unable to manage this. We are also concerned about the communal bins being by the main entrance to the flats and not enclosed like all the existing bin sheds in the flats around the estate. They are housed in sheds. This is clearly unsatisfactory. This would be an open invitation to fly tippers and to add another location to the list of legal dumping grounds. Finally, we are disappointed that the council and planners have apparently had no regard for the Localism Act of 2012, requiring local authorities, local authorities to consult residents in making plan decisions which affect the whole area. We were given only 16 days to organise and register our objection to the plans. If we were informed of the planning stage and invited to sit round the table as PTRA members with developers, planners and council representatives, as prescribed in the Localism Act, we could have come up to a compromise agreement about the project.
You have 1 minute.
Yep, I'll finish now. Which is best to meet the needs of the community. Our estate has over 2 bungalows, far fewer than most other estates in the world. We have been given a choice. If we had given a choice to what to build in that place, the Bell Hotel, we would have set in bungalows to allow tenants to downsize, plus to open up existing rental accommodations, and for the younger families and younger people and families. So, that's it.
Thank you.
Just
with
us,
the committee, whether, first of all, I'll ask some questions of
yes.
application people myself to help our last members of the if there's any questions you might wish to put us in.
Hi, yes, thank you for your permission. Are you against building on the actual site, or are you against the design of this particular?
Just the design of the flat, sir. We're not against any buildings at all within the region that the community would accept. We don't. We know there is a need for housing, as I say. But if you could reduce the size of the building, we most probably would accept that. But we need to talk, obviously. But we've said that three stories could be compromised if we could maybe deal with that.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Bell. Can I ask you said there was no consultation, we only had 16 days notice.
Yes, sir.
Okay, in the report that we have before us, there's a sentence that says a supporting statement has been submitted by the agent acting for the developer following a public meeting held with the agent and local residents. Were you aware of that?
No, sir. I was going to put that in the notes, but I was told to keep it short and brief, but in the plans of application, it stated that we had full consultation with the community, and he had that down twice, and he never at all. And I've even sent emails and asked them if he could come and talk to us. And it was about after 5 weeks he said to me that we're sorry for not getting back to you, but can we meet? And I said, well, I'm sorry, we haven't got the time, we've got to put our own house in order before you, because we didn't want to change everything again.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your presentation. Can I ask you if there is a representative for the applicant who wishes to speak? If you could introduce yourself and tell us who you represent, and you will have 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. My name is Victoria Alderton, Director of Paddock Johnson Partnership. I'm the architect and also the agent, and we've provided this statement on behalf of the applicant. The proposed development provides 100% affordable housing, the need for which is highlighted in the Wirral Housing Strategy, and utilises a brownfield site within an established residential area. Proposals will provide 28 new affordable homes, 7 of which have been designed to meet the needs of the elderly and people with mobility issues, with level access to out and walking shelf facilities. Onward Homes is committed to providing quality affordable homes for those most in need. They allocate through the local choice-based letting scheme, which ensures fairness and that those in the most housing need are allocated properties. Every property is managed by a dedicated safer neighbourhoods team, and incidents of antisocial behaviour are dealt with quickly and effectively in line with stringent tenancy agreements. That said, it is considered that replacing a failing public house with modern new apartments will serve to reduce antisocial behaviour rather than increase it. The number of apartments needed on the scheme has been determined through a robust commercial viability appraisal which balances land values, build costs and rental rates over a period of years. This appraisal established that 28 apartments is the minimum number required to make the scheme financially viable, and proposals have been developed on that basis. The layout of the site has been designed to minimise the impact of the new building on surrounding properties by maximising interface distances to the properties on Dickens Avenue whilst maintaining the established building line on Penton Hall Road. The scale of the buildings in keeping with the area matching the heights of the adjacent four-storey blocks of flats to either side and will positively contribute to the streetscape with a feature entrance which addresses the corner of Penton Hall Road and Goldsmith Way. On-site car parking is provided to the rear to further minimise the impact on surrounding properties, and this utilises an existing access from the public highway. As has been said, parking provision is provided at one space per apartment, which represents the maximum parking provision outlined within the SPD. Furthermore, enclosed cycle storage for 28 bicycles is also provided to encourage sustainable means of transport for shorter journeys. The The development is also supported by Homes England, bringing much needed funding to the area. The construction of the apartments will also support the local supply chain through jobs and apprenticeships. Local schools will be engaged with both contractors as well as the local community and immediate businesses. In conclusion, we feel proposals will make a positive contribution to the area, providing much needed high quality affordable housing in an area where we know there is significant demand. The proposals will also redevelop the brownfield site, bringing new residents to the area, which in turn will help support local businesses. Our proposals comply with all relevant planning policy as demonstrated by the recommendations to approve, and on that basis we hope the committee can approve this evening.
So are you willing to accept some questions or clarification? Any questions from members?
Storage. I know it's not a lot up there, and we prefer to see safer storage containers than any plants or sort of lockable sort of thing.
It's covered in closed cycle storage, I suppose, with the ability to lock bikes purely in line with the request from that we received through the session.
I just feel that there should be a lot of buildings and sort of where you're a little bit more secure than just
Thank you, Chair. Thank you very much for the presentation. We've heard from residents that they're not opposed to the development, per se. What they are opposed to is the four stories. Now, you've said that you need 28 apartments to make it viable, economically viable. Could you not have worked with the residents in so much as reducing the height, maybe building into the roof space to lower the overall height of the building? Have you considered anything like that to accommodate the residents and address some of their concerns?
There's a number of different options and feasibility study prior to producing the application with fewer apartments. And different configurations, and that was not able to be made to work from a viability point of view financially. So what we've got in this proposal is the minimum required. Onward Homes are a non-profit organisation, so they're not, they had the viability, it's not got lots and lots of profit built into that. In terms of building into the roof space, it's a flat roof building to try and make sure it's in keeping the surrounding lots of flats, and there isn't I'm not sure that would make a difference in terms of the overall mass in that regard. In relation to consultation prior to the application going in, this was a sensitive subject for the, or sensitive issue for the owner of the pub, who was concerned about the impact that may have on his business in the run-up to the application submitted, and that made it quite difficult to fully engage prior to the submission.
I'll just explore that last comment a bit further. You heard from the previous speaker that they felt they hadn't been consulted. And yet there's a statement in the report before us tonight that says that you had a public meeting with local residents. What can you talk us through that a bit more, please? So we're satisfied that you have done what you think you've done to engage with the community, where we clearly have an established tenants and residents association.
The statement that you're referring to relates to a public consultation that we had post the application being submitted. When we were made aware that there were objections, we made contact, and it took some time to agree dates, but that's when we went and had the meeting with the Residents Association.
Do you want to tell us who's going to go first?
My turn to go first this time.
Fergus Cook for Prentice Ward. Okay, well, Alan has covered all the essential concerns about application while making it clear. The senior residents don't oppose increasing Prentice's affordable housing stock in principle. As a ward councillor, I'd just like to expand on a few points he made. It's too easy to take shelter behind the fact that Wirral Council's local plan is no longer fit for purpose. The absence of an up-to-date detailed local plan should not serve as an excuse to wade through residential planning applications without due regard to the likely impact on existing communities. A little more about the local advice for 2011. The government website gives a summary of the purpose and principles underlying the Localism Act. The key points include new rights and powers for communities and individuals, reforms to make the planning system more democratic and more effective, reforms to ensure that decisions about housing are taken locally. I'll just go over the key words there again. Communities, individuals, democratic and local housing decisions. Now against this background, clearly the consultation period and deadline for comments on the application were inadequate. I know the council has its rules about making online comments and so on, but we're talking more broadly about the general consultation period. However, even if more time had been given for the consultation, the essential principle involving members of the community at the outset of any housing project was missing, because we're still talking about a project being put to residents to comment on rather than them being involved at the outset, which is a key difference in principle. As you've heard Alan say, if the community had been consulted in the first instance, a preference for bungalows for the elderly and disabled over multi-storey flats may well have been expressed. I've been making a point about silent sheds. Councillor C. Hayes made that point. I believe that after the site visit and after discussions which followed that, this was raised and the architects have undertaken to make the planting sheds secure and covered, because if they're not, sooner or later, however well locked, the bags will be stolen. And of course, it is a very laudable environmental principle to encourage planting usage, so the fact that 28 ample spaces are provided for, provided they are secure, is good. Okay, a final point about the design. Now, I'm no architect, but a thoughtful resident did suggest to me an alternative configuration for the proposed flats, which may be feasible. If a bottom apartment block has to be built, wouldn't a sensible compromise be to flip it around 90 degrees to be in line with the existing Dell Hotel? Even if this required scaling the project down to some extent, and I have to say without seeing the details of the viability calculations in terms of the cost effective, but I'm not convinced that it couldn't be scaled down and still be sort of paid for. The parking landscaped area would then be to the side, not obscuring the shots, and so leaving most of the open community area intact, because this is the greatest sense I feel. I've been living here for so long and cycling up and down here, this open space that was obviously planned to be that way. If this building came off its width, and its height, it would completely visually take out and practically take out so much of that community area. So, if this were left intact, the community area, it would then be more in harmony with the existing estate. So, in summary, then, I would ask the committee to reject the application in its present form, in the open expectation that the applicants will produce a modified project more in line with the residents' wishes. And I do that. Thanks for some speaking.
Thanks.
Questions?
Well, does anybody have any questions?
It's off now.
It's off now.
It's off now. Thank you, Chair, members of the Planning Committee. Listening to the representations from the residents, representatives of Prenton, I'd just like to magnify and echo what's being said, you know. I've also run the consultation process. We haven't had time to properly engage and consultate around this, and there seems to be room for manoeuvre, you know, in the actual knocking down of a really loved community pub and being replaced by this massive tower block that's going to overshadow the whole of the area, you know. Prenton is a much loved place, and particularly in that particular area, the residents have got a strong sense of community, and I think what they're saying basically is they would have loved the chance to meet with the developer and develop plans together, you know, and that's what community planning should be all about, you know. I know a lot of them, as I say, are quite sad to lose the community pub, and I would have liked that opportunity. My major concern is the traffic concerns, and it's been articulated by Alan regarding the public transport. Public transport has been reduced all the time in Prenton. Bus services, one of our bus companies that was based around Prenton, Avon, went bankrupt, and stagecoaches have had to take over their services. They're now finding that they can't run them commercially at a profit. So they're reducing, we're just having a consultation now on Stagecoach, reducing their services, the ones they took over from Avon. So people are having a lot of difficulty in Prenton because there's no railway stations around Prenton within walking distance. The nearest one is Rockferry Station, which is 2 or 3 miles away. So people, residents are finding it very hard to access, unless they've got a vehicle, to access fresh food and medical attention, and also social side of things. 28 cars, park space for 28 cars within the grounds of the flats, that's fine and that's great. But what about the people who are visiting the area? I'm a governor at the local school, Prent Primary School, and I've created, along with the residents and along with the other governors, I've been asked to create a forum around the school, because the school drop-off and pick-up time is an absolute nightmare, and there's a lot of antisocial behaviour going on with people who are dropping the kids off, parking all over the place basically. I'm getting phone calls on a daily basis from the school and the head teacher regarding that, and this is only going to make that situation worse, you know, because it's not just about the cars that the people in the flats own, it's also the visitors that they're going to be having and so forth, you know. And as Alan rightly says, you know, them roads are not built for the volumes of traffic that are coming through at the moment, which is being made worse by the absence of public transport. People are being forced to use their own cars, you know, which doesn't help us either with our climate emergency, you know. So I would like the planning committee to take that into consideration and give the residents a chance to talk to the developer and come up with a better proposal. Thank you very much. Cheers.
Any members, any questions? Thank you. Okay, I'll go to members to make any observations or ask any questions.
Thank you, Chair. Before I start, I'd just like to thank the PTRA, the developer, and both my ward colleagues. I think they were really broad contributions that we looked at this issue really widely. And I think, as Alan started, it's definitely worth looking at this holistically and looking at the positive, because there definitely are some in this development. As the developer noted, there's affordable housing and an early potential to cater to people with mobility issues. There are really good facilities and a library nearby, which you know, definitely not every development has the chance to have that. It is brownfield site, which helps us, you know, in terms of our housing target, and it potentially gives families the opportunity to get on the housing ladder for the first time within their area. I think all of these, if you look at them like that, they're all absolutely positives, but I think it's definitely worth looking at what the concerns of the residents are, and for me, I think they potentially overshadow them. This is, you know, we all just heard all the different contributions. This is a really significant development for the area, and from my perspective, and as my colleagues were, you know, were there every day, it terms of where the development sit, I think it would physically cast a shadow and would also, you know, cast a mental shadow over the shops. We must all be hearing all the time about the risk to the high street, the demise of the high street right around the country. This is an area that thrives, and there are, you know, the shops and the libraries, there's an awful lot of facilities there. People not being able to see them and then being cast into shadow, I think, would really dramatically impact their footfall, and I think could really put some local businesses and therefore livelihoods at risk. Similarly, Goldsmith Way, which is a small road as you come out of the Dell and hang right, is already a narrow road, and I think already under significant pressure, with the potential for just one parking space per flat. The parking, I think it would be a real nightmare. People coming in and out, and you know, as Councillor Norby pointed out, the impact on, you know, key times, such as and pickups, I think would be even worse there. And it does note, so in part 3.5.4, it talks about the transport access, and as it is, you know, as my whole colleague pointed out, and as Mr. Story did, Penton has been really struggling as a result of where we've had our buses cut. So you can't, I think, talk about this being a really well connected area from a public transport perspective. Not when we don't have a train station, and the bus offer is really, really reduced. And so I think from my perspective, there are definitely positives on the developer side. They could have definitely engaged with the residents more, and it's unusual, I think, to hear residents say, "We're welcoming development, we just don't want this development. Please, you know, listen to us." And there are definitely positives, absolutely, but from my perspective, there's an awful lot of negatives in terms of the changing landscape of the area and the real significant impact on locally held businesses and the library, which I think would be really positive by this committee.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. With regard to the application, and I want to thank everyone for the submissions, it's interesting that many objections are not against the type of development of housing on the proposed sites, but rather instead showing unhappiness with the design itself and dissatisfaction at how the current application impacts development in the area. In its current form and shape, or simply put, its overall mass, I believe it does not scale well to the surrounding properties, and I therefore feel that the application, as it stands, would result in a detrimental change of character within the area. With this in mind, I have some workers to reject the application in its current form, if you want to hear it.
I'll just take a few more contributions,
Okay, just first of all, a question, because the application frames itself demolition of the former building of flats. From my understanding, demolition of property would not be planning permission per se. If we just wish to get the module, is that just to open the first?
It would need to go through a prior approval process, but it does form part of this application.
Because I think really, once you get over the lamentable decision of a pub closing, people who know me quite like pubs, once you get over the lamentable decision of a local pub closing and the emotions around that, we then move on to what the development is actually going to bring. And sadly, you know, pubs are closing all around Birkenhead and so on and so forth. They are struggling on a number of cases. So the last thing we want is a pub to close, lay idle, and become a target of vandalism. I actually think the application is one of the most positive ones we've had to this committee for a long time. It is an organisation that's non-profit. It is effectively a social housing project, or is described as affordable housing. It is in a part of the area that there's a need. I'll talk from my own experience in the area of Ireland. We have a similar development in our sort of mini area in the town centre. And people are queued up to get there, and they're from the local area because they want to stay in the area, but want to either downsize or develop and to keep that affection. People love Brenton, and we've heard that a number of times. People desire and love Brenton and want to live there. I've looked at the issues of design, and I am sort of bemused by, it's a bit like Jim Bowen, let's see what we've got about. Well, that's not the way the planning committee works. We are presented with the application as it is, and we can't design on the hoof and create a utopia as we go on. It's the application has before us, and it seems as though it's been well considered. Viability is always an issue. It is as far away, if you look where the park area is, as far away from the shops, it seems to be saying their own shadow. And I think the shops are well visible because of the play area that is there. So the play area does give a fairly general view to the playground across. So you can see from a number of points in the area and the other shops across the road. So there is still interconnection between the shopping area and the developments. I guess it will be a matter of personal judgments about design and you know, size. There are other flats in the area, and they will not be as attractive as these. This will probably make them look a bit embarrassing, a bit tardy. So my view is that, on balance, unless we could really defend the issue of what is beauty in the eye of the beholder, almost, about design, I think it's a very difficult job defending this, given the need for the housing. The fact that there is transport links, not perfect, I would accept that, not perfect, there is transport links. My overall view is that it would be very difficult to defend, you know, purely on one issue, material issue of design and you know, effect on the street scene, etc., etc., those type of material design. I think it would be very difficult to get a passing inspector, given what we know of inspectors' decisions over a number of periods of time and the drive for more housing. This is exactly the type of housing we need. It is desired. It's got facilities for people who with disabilities. I think my general view is that it is a more pluses than minuses, and would be inclined unless I hear a really strong debate about this.
I was going to ask Matthew about the light issue. So this is brought to our attention that I don't know the area very well, but basically that there is a light issue. On that basis, I would agree with what Steve said, and surprise that we often have come to the planning committee applications that don't include affordable housing or not very much affordable housing, and it's refreshing to see that there are affordable housing on brownfield sites. So I would agree with Councillor Foulkes.
Thanks, Chair. I think it's an observation or a planning comment. I think when we looked at previous planning applications by other social landlords, not this one, particularly one of Banks Road in West Kirby, where they said they couldn't develop affordable housing, and clearly on this site we have totally affordable housing. I just think it's regrettable that